association that has now lasted 43 years, to our everlasting delight. We're glad you're with us for this very special edition of Tigers Weekly. I'm John Keating. We're at the press box here at Comerica Park, where they celebrate the Tigers' long and storied history. And for the longest time, the Tigers' history has involved our friend Ernie Harwell. This is a special edition of Tigers Weekly, our tribute to Ernie. It's impossible not to like him. He just won't allow it. And ever since Comerica Park opened in 1999, this has been Ernie's home, the radio booth above the field here at Comerica Park. But for a couple of generations of us now, his home has been within our homes. That slow, syrupy voice coming out of the small little radio on the picnic table, or perhaps out of the alarm clock next to your bed. Ernie is our own little treasure, and we begin our tribute to Ernie by taking him to another of his homes, to Cooperstown, where he has residence, and he talks of another Hall of Fame resident, the greatest Tiger of them all.
Here he is, the greatest Tiger of them all, Tyrus Raymond Cobb, and I tell you, 367 lifetime batting average. A guy today would love to settle for that for 1 year, wouldn't he?
Well, when we go down to the records room and look at the top hitters of all time, he's right at the top.
Absolutely, and here he is when he first broke in as a rookie in Detroit after coming up from Augusta in 1905, got a double off of Jack Chesbro, if I remember right, and then his Tiger sweater here, and later went to play for Mr. Connie Mack in his final years, and it was while he was playing for Connie that he's got his 4,000th hit at Navin Field. Yes. But what about this letter? What is it? It looks like it's written to Bobby Doerr. Dale?
Ty Cobb is misunderstood, and if you begin to understand his life a little bit, certainly there were some devils in him, some demons, but he also was a very charitable guy, and he loved to follow baseball in his retirement years, and he used to write to players who he admired. He admired the way they played, and here's a letter from Ty Cobb to Bobby Doerr, telling him that he admired his style of play. He also loved Nellie Fox, and he liked the players that played with some fire, and he loved the game to be played well. He had a tremendous respect and love for the game until the day he died.
Well, he was the greatest Tiger who ever played, and certainly a great member of the Hall of Fame, the original class, wasn't he?
Yes, he was one of the first elected. Mm-hmm. It was Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, Walter Johnson, Christy Mathewson, and Hannes Wagner.
Wow. Pretty good lineup, I'd say.
They went in 1939.
Mm-hmm. Well, here's another Ty Cobb item. It looks like, is this a real diary? Did he write this himself?
He wrote this, and you'll see some really interesting entries in here. This is 1 month of his life in 1946. And I want to show you some things that may take you by surprise. And I'll just turn it. He went to church on the 2nd.
Mm-hmm.
Then the next day, he went to San Francisco and saw his divorce lawyer.
Okay. We'll settle for less. I like that.
And then he ordered two cases of Old Forester.
All right.
Okay. My favorite entry by Cobb in here has to do with a golf match he played at Del Monte in San Francisco mm-hmm. against DiMaggio. He says, I shot a 71 at Del Monte. I won 6 presses off DiMaggio. He can't putt for big money. Went to bed early. But all kinds of things.
Isn't that great?
He just read Hemingway.
Mm-hmm.
Find this again. Stormy, stayed indoors, read Hemingway on boxing. I owe him a letter. A lot of talk about seeing Hemingway,
yeah.
Seeing Hearst. And folks like that.
He didn't write a whole lot, but it was very interesting what he wrote.
Yeah, mm-hmm. it's an interesting way to keep a diary. I think if you limit yourself to a few sentences, you'll mm-hmm. be more apt to do a diary, I think.
Right.
There's really one interesting entry in here that deals with Cochran, which I think is quite surprising. And I'll just find this here for us. Heard from Cochran, Ruth seriously ill. M. Mickey
mm-hmm.
thinks it may be the big strikeout for him. Okay.
Yeah.
He also loaned Cochran $2,000 for an operation
mm-hmm.
because Cochran didn't have the money. So,
yeah.
So Cobb could be a tough guy, but he was also a very charitable guy too.
Absolutely.
Ernie, I'll show you a little something here.
All right.
On the first day that I was in my first board meeting with the mm-hmm. Hall of Fame, when they were announcing me as the president, Bowie Kuhn spoke up and said, Dale, remember, there's other teams besides the Detroit Tigers. And what Bowie didn't know is that I carry with me in my business card case a tobacco card of Ty Cobb,
wow.
1909, so that the Tigers are always with me wherever I go.
Isn't that terrific? 1990, won the Triple Crown that year.
He certainly did.
Fantastic.
Well, there you go. While Ty Cobb might be considered the greatest Tiger of them all, there is not much doubt that Ernie will be the greatest Tiger announcer of them all. It's all Ernie on this edition of Tigers Weekly. And on many nights on this rather troubling Tiger season, Ernie has been the best thing going as far as Detroit and Detroit baseball fans are concerned. And as we continue on the show, we'll show you some of the tributes he's received throughout his travels in his final season. We'll always remember his farewell to Tiger Stadium. We'll share that with you coming up as well. But up next, can you guess which of his astounding number of baseball moments is his own personal favorite? And just how many games do you suppose he's called? We'll answer those questions. Tigers Weekly continues from Comerica Park in a moment.
Sets and pitches, swings a long fly ball to left. Maybe it's gone. A home run.
Well, neither Jim Price nor Ernie Harwell had any idea back in 1968 that ultimately they would be broadcasting partners for years and years, for a while on television, but for the last whack of time, here in the radio booth covering Tiger baseball. And this is the vantage point that they share as they describe Tiger baseball, the headsets. This is a cough button in broadcasting terms. If one of the guys has a tickle, they just push that button and you at home are none the wiser for it. Ernie will take memories of people into his retirement. Those are the memories that he holds dearest. But from a team perspective, certainly the championship years stand out. Can you guess his all-time favorite broadcasting memories? In 60 years, he only has a zillion of them from which to choose.
Hi again, good lookers. You know, I've been lucky enough to be at some great ball games and to have some great thrills behind the microphone. And we've picked up a few of them here and we want to pass them along to you. The first one is September the 14th, 1968, when Denny McLain wins his 30th game. The Oakland A's are playing the Tigers at Tiger Stadium. Man on first and a man on third. One man down, 2-2 the count on Willie Horton. Here's a set by Segee.
Swung on, a drive to the left. That'll be the ball game. It's over ahead of Gonza. McLain wins his 30th. Here comes the champion score. Willie Horton, single, and the ball game is over. And the Tigers win it 5-4.
And McLain has his 30th victory of the 1968 season. Our next one is September the 17th, 1968, when the Tigers clinched the pennant. The Yankees were playing at Tiger Stadium. Well, this big crowd here ready to break loose. Three men on, two out, game tied, 1-1 in the ninth inning. McDaniel checking his sign with Jake Gibbs, the tall right-hander ready to go to work again. And the windup and the pitch, he swings.
The line shot, base hit, right field, the Tigers win it. Here comes K-Line to score, and it's all over. Downward singles, the Tigers mob down. K-Line has scored, the fans are steaming on the field. And the Tigers
have won their first pennant since 1945. Let's listen to the bedlam here at Tiger Stadium. Now we go to October the 10th, 1968. The World Series, Game 7. Detroit at St. Louis. Jim Northrop at bat against Bob Gibson. Now the set by Gibson. We're ready. There's a swing and a fly ball to center.
Here comes by digging hard. He almost fell down. It's over his head. We're ahead. Cash is rounding third. He scores. Willie Horton rounding third. He scores.
Northrop goes on to third base. Detroit leads 2-0. Now the World Series in 1984. This is Game 5, October the 14th. San Diego at Detroit. Ball one on Kirk. Here's the pitch. He swings. There's a long drive to right. It's a home run for Gibson. A three-run homer. The Tigers lead it 8-4 in the eighth inning. Well, those are some memories from behind the microphone. And we'll see you again next time.
Well, there was a moment at Yankee Stadium when the Tigers were there last weekend, and we invited Ernie to describe an inning of Tiger baseball, and you got the feeling that it was one of those moments when you were watching something special. Hall of Famer Ernie Harwell describing a baseball game at the house that Ruth built. And by his own estimation, Ernie figures he's now been a part of 8,400 baseball broadcasts, and we've seen it all season long. A PR guy for some team will sidle up to Ernie and say, Mr. Harwell, here's what we'd like you to do. And he'd say always the same thing, whatever you want. The tributes have been many for Ernie as he's taken his victory lap through baseball. And we'll share some of those with you. The Tigers Weekly continues from Comerica Park after this.
It's a story about turf.
You must be feeling very happy.
I feel real good, Ernie. You know, they on the radio, they think we've been doing, we came back up, we was down, and this feels great.
And you beat one of the real tough pitchers in baseball, and Mr. Bob Gibson, didn't you?
That's true. Now we number one.
Those words were music to our ears, those of us who had waited so long for a baseball championship in Detroit. And Ernie, who's a part of the wall of Hall of Famers here at Comerica Park, is not just admired in Detroit, but throughout all of baseball. And we have looked with delight and amazement at the energy that Ernie has shown in this, his last lap through the game. He has made time for everyone who's wanted a little piece of him at all of the Tiger stops along the way. And in some of those stops, the best thing about having the Tigers in town was to hear that voice and see that smile at least one more time. Will tell us privately that while he's been appreciative of all the attention he's received this baseball season, there's also a part of him that will be somewhat relieved when all the attention has come and gone. And no tribute to Ernie Harwell can be complete without the inclusion of Tiger Stadium. As you'll remember, Ernie was a big part of the closing ceremonies at the corner, and we'll relive that emotional day when we come right back. It was Ernie Harwell who gave the place its nickname. After a while, the corner of Michigan and Trumbull was shortened to The Corner, and it was home to Ernie for 40 summers of broadcasting. But even at 84, Ernie Harwell is not so set in his ways that he doesn't embrace change. While he loved Tiger Stadium, he also has loved working here at Comerica Park. And the man is a rock. While he is truly passionate about the things he holds dear, moments of emotion are usually swept away by a smile. It's his sunny outlook on life. But when the Tigers and Tiger fans said goodbye to Tiger Stadium, the rock cracked a bit. And we loved him for it.
Thank you, John. Our goodbyes to this famous corner are over. Capacity crowd here tonight was paid a final tribute. And the Tigers and the city of Detroit were very proud of the way that this huge and enthusiastic crowd
conducted itself. It was a tremendous thrill to see the honor and respect accorded this Michigan landmark. It wasn't easy to say goodbye. Nobody wants to walk away from a treasure. We did it with a lump in our throat and a tear in our eyes. For almost 40 years, I've spent as much time at this corner of Michigan in trouble as I have at home. I've been elated, dejected, thrilled, and disappointed here. I've sweltered through the summer heat, and I've frozen in the spring and the fall. In sickness and in health, then my home, my office, and my refuge. When I came here in 1960, it was Briggs Stadium, and then Tigers Stadium. And then somewhere along the way, I began to call it the corner of Michigan and Trumbull, and then shortened it to just the corner. I know this place through the century has been Bennett Park, Navin Field, Briggs Stadium, and Tiger Stadium. But to me, it will always be the corner, the most famous corner in Michigan. Tiger Stadium has been a dear friend. And even though I look forward to our new home, Comerica Park, and to the thrill of watching new Tiger stars, this old corner and its great players will remain a timeless gift of the past. Tonight, in saying goodbye, we have celebrated our great teams and our outstanding players. The 1934-1935 champions pulled our city out of the Great Depression, and the 68 Tigers were part of Detroit's healing process following those terrible riots of 1967. The 84 champions were great too, and we have a special place in our hearts for them. And tonight we felt the presence of those great stars of the past. We remember the flashing spikes of Ty Cobb, the grace of Charlie Gehringer, the power of Hank Greenberg, and the classic consistency of Al Kaline, and then that durable duo of the Keystone, Lou Whitaker and Alan Trammell. Next year, I hope you'll join me at the new Comerica Park, where future memories will begin to take root. We'll be there to cheer on the new players and the new teams. The view will be spectacular, and all of us will greet with great enthusiasm a new era in baseball in Detroit. As for Tiger Stadium, well, this corner is part of our history, our heritage. It's been magic, hope, and the true heartbeat of our city. We've been part of those memories, and we treasure them. From generation to generation, we've joined the joyous crowd. And all of us love this old place, and its closing has tugged at our hearts. For all of us here at Fox Sports Net, Detroit, to all of you, this is Ernie Harwell saying, so long from the corner of Michigan and Trumbull, Bennett Park, Navin Field, Briggs Stadium, and Tiger Stadium. We'll remember.
Wow, it still causes goosebumps. You can see that Ernie was rather emotional about the closing of Tiger Stadium. Hopefully we'll borrow a little bit of his poise when we say goodbye to a legend that we'll remember.
Hi again, good lookers. I'm Ernie Harwell.
We're here to honor one of baseball's all-time greatest broadcasters, Hall of Fame voice of the Detroit Tigers, Ernie Harwell.
You know, radio and baseball have been married for a long, long time.
Wow, looks like we got a Tiger fan around here. Who would that be?
I wonder.
We're down in the basement now at the Hall of Fame at Cooperstown. This is where they hide the really good stuff. And by the way, how do you like my gloves, Dr. Harwell? And I'm a proud guy. I got to have a raise. And Jim said, all right, I'll raise your salary one penny the next year. I'll start off with a mitt. I don't really know where this one came from, but it's big and it is stiff. Believe me, this is an old-fashioned infielder's glove. I rode the trains with Roy Campanella, Jackie Robinson, Pee Wee Reese, all those great boys of summer. He had a little whiskey on his breath. I didn't mind that at all. He didn't seem to mind it either. I asked him if I could do the interview. He said, yes, young man, come on in. I sat down, and for 15 minutes, Ty Cobb told me baseball stories. So I was reading the paper, and Leo slapped my paper right back in my face. So I grabbed him, and we began to wrestle. Wow, I tell you, scandals are right all over the place.
Ladies and gentlemen, get your scorecards and pencils ready.
Johnny Hill from Douglasville never hit and never will. I might have put him to sleep in the first inning. He might have left me in the fifth. It might have been the 19th. I don't know when, but I put him to sleep. That announcement that Ernie made about the game being postponed was erroneous. Ernie, wherever you are, come on back. That's it for now. See you next time.
At Advance Auto.
Question that her condition
remain private tonight. Jason Terzis, straight ahead with sports.
Ernie D. Brown cranks his body. Ernie's wife of 61 years, Lulu, was taken to a hospital with an irregular heartbeat. There is no report on her condition tonight. Finally,
before yesterday's game,
her illness may have taken a little away from such a special day, but Ernie says he really couldn't have asked for anything more.
It couldn't have been any better for me. I appreciated not only the people attending, but the wonderful things they said about me. And I felt like I was getting an overload of sugar, you know, and I was going to get diabetes or something. It was so bad. But it was nice and a little embarrassing, but I made it through.
He's so humble.
Showing the love.
Nice sign for Ernie. Top of the third, Rondale White puts a little stank on it. That's a double. 4-1 Yanks. Moving to the fifth, Ernie, take it away.
On the mound, there's a drive hit to deep left, and it is long gone. A home run for Easley to cut the lead to 4-3.
I'm going to miss that voice, but not this season. Detroit has lost 20. City today, we're going to hear from Ernie, and we're going to recap the weekend in college football. Cobby is out in Pittsburgh. Fred Well has broadcast his last game in Detroit. Last Sunday was the official Ernie Harwell Day at Comerica Park. I guess you can call this one the unofficial one. Ernie's last game at Comerica Park in Detroit. Tigers close out the season on the road, and of course, all the players there, Joe Torre, David Wells, the Yankees, everyone honoring Ernie. As for the game, kind of anticlimactic. Yankees take it. That was Rondale White with the base hit, brings home Raul Mondesi. Yanks take it 4-3. But obviously, everyone's thoughts with Ernie Harwell today as he leaves the booth at Comerica Park for the very last time.
And most of all, let me once again thank all you fans for the warmth and love and affection and the loyalty that you've shown. And I hope that you'll continue to come out and support the Tigers. They've got a wonderful organization. And I know that someday we'll see the glory that was Detroit in baseball renewed. We've got a great team in the front office, Mr. Dave Dombrowski and all his folks. They're going to make a big U-turn, and we've got to stay loyal to the Tigers. And once again, thank you, and God bless you.
Be sure to join us next week on Sports Overtime.
Firing Randy Smith is
general manager, if you ask me. The Tigers' firing of Ernie Harwell was a PR nightmare. Fans threatened to boycott. Why would you fire a Hall of Famer who still calls a great game, not to mention is one of the true gentlemen in the business? Ernie eventually got his job back, and this time he gets to go out on his terms. And he told our Jason Terzis he's grateful to Tiger owner Mike Ilitch for giving him that chance.
The first thing he said to me was that you're going to be my announcer and you can work as long as you want to. And I really appreciated his trust and confidence in me. And that was probably one of the most gratifying things in my whole career when Mike told me that.
Be sure to join us on Thursday for Jason's special in-depth report, Ernie Harwell, The Last Call. That's Thursday night at 11 o'clock. Ernie started his next-to-last series in Kansas City.
Everybody all right? Got a beautiful day. Let's keep the rain away. I'm at the chapel today, so I'm going over there now. Well, I'm a turtle on a fence post, and I know a lot of you guys go hunting. You walk through fields. And once in a while, you see a turtle up on a fence post. And when you see that, you have to realize that that turtle didn't get there by himself. There's no way a turtle could get on the top of a fence post. Somebody has to put him up there. And whatever fence post I'm on, I'm there because of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Before we had chapel, we had sort of a joke that my religion was the church nearest the hotel, you know, on Sunday morning.
He's waiting, and here's the first pitch. It backs him off an inside curve from Mike Moran.
The Yanks are tough in the early innings, they're tough in the late innings, and they're tough in the middle innings. There's a swing and a tip foul off the mid of Rivera. 1-1, they count on him. 3-0 Yanks on top in the first.
Hurry up and get home, Ernie.
This may be the final out of my Tiger home season. There's a little roller hit the first base. It is picked up, a fair ball, touched on the bag by Johnson. The game's over, the season is over. Thanks for everything, everybody in Detroit. And the final score here in the final game, the Yankees 4 and the Tigers 3.
Hi, folks. All right. All right.
Ernie, the Tigers, Jim Stapleton, want you to have home plate from Comerica Park from your final game as a broadcaster in Detroit.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
The Detroit Tigers proudly announced today that commencing with opening day 2003, the entire press box level of Comerica Park will be renamed the Ernie Harwell Media Center.
Wow.
We all have intersections in our life, and I'm going to reach another crossroad and hope the traffic light's with me when I cross the street.
Well, Sunday in Toronto is Ernie Harwell's final game ever. Our entire pregame show will be dedicated to him. We hope you'll join us for that. That's it for this pregame show. I'm John Keating. Back to the studio. Here's Matt Biondi.
John, thanks. Coming up, Tiger Stadium was a great place to work. We were down there where we could hear him cuss and see him sweat, and we were so close. And I'd had guys who played center field come to me and say, Ernie, I heard your broadcast last night. Oh, loudmouth, and the wind was blowing out. But it was a great view, and you had an intimacy there that's hard to match. And I think we've had so many great memories there.
He off the bag at first. The pitch, he swings on this, a fly ball to left. Here comes Herndon. He's there. He's got it. The Tigers are the champions of 1984.
I think probably the World Series games would be my fondest memories at Tiger Stadium. But there were a lot of opening games that meant a lot to me, too. And I think most of all, probably, the final game was the culmination of it. That was the best moment, I believe, I had at Tiger Stadium.
And you can see the entire sit-down interview with Ernie Harwell on Sunday during the Tigers pregame, which airs at 12:30, right before Ernie's final game right here on Fox Sports Net.
He's been the voice of summer for more than four decades. Tonight, a special look at Ernie Harwell.
Also tonight, the CDC says it can inoculate us.
Here's the pitch. He swings, there's a long drive to right, and it is a home run for Gibson!
Up next, we're going to say goodbye to a legend, a special look at the amazing life and work of Ernie Harwell.
5 years in the broadcast booth, 42 of them with the Detroit Tigers, Ernie Harwell was signing off. He's been honored all season long, not only in Detroit, but in just about every city the Tigers have played. But for a while there, it looked as if Ernie's farewell tour would be cut short by a player strike. Fortunately, it didn't happen. And now, with the last game of the season coming on Sunday, Ernie can say goodbye and make the last call the way he always should have, with dignity and class.
The second you tune into the game.
Well, we've got blue skies. We've got a beautiful evening. 73 degrees here at game time.
You hear that unmistakable voice.
A few little fleecy clouds up there, but just another great day at the ballpark.
Ernie Harwell is the voice of summer.
Outfield a little bit to right on the Michael, hitting 234.
He's the voice who brings you inside the radio and onto the field. He makes you feel like you're sitting right there next to him.
A curveball in too close, 2-0.
My job is just to sit down and tell people what's happening.
Listening to Ernie is like listening to an old friend.
Swing and a miss. He struck him out. They go 1-2-3 again.
But he's more than that to Nick Gassaway and Jim Debus. He is their eyes.
He just paints everything clear for me.
Nick and Jim depend on Ernie to paint that picture because they're visually impaired.
Bounding ball deep third.
Get out! Get out! Oh!
They go to about 15 games a year, usually sitting in the outfield stands, and they never come without their radio.
Come on, Chris!
To them, nothing beats sitting in the park, blending into the crowd, listening to Ernie describe the action.
If you listen to other people, you hear them just talking about other stuff while pitches are going on, and you can't really follow where Ernie, it's every pitch, you know, Ben's winning first strike, way outside, swings and misses, that kind of thing. You know, and he's got his, you know, the two-for-one call, you know, all that stuff is his.
Bird delivers, and Simon swings and hits one in the right field. It is deep, it is way back, and it is long gone. A home run, 1-0 Detroit.
No wonder you see more people wearing headphones at Comerica Park, especially this season, Ernie's last. He's been honored all over the country, first pitches, team jerseys, autographs, a statue. He even rang the bell at the New York Stock Exchange.
I've gotten more attention than I deserve or need.
This isn't the first time Ernie is saying goodbye. A decade ago, Tigers management told him they wanted to go in a new direction and unceremoniously fired him. Ernie Harwell, fired.
It was the worst decision I've ever seen made.
Tiger fans were outraged. But the next year, when owner Mike Ilitch bought the team, one of the first moves he made was to bring back Ernie.
The first thing he said to me was that you're going to be my announcer and you can work as long as you want to. That was probably one of the most gratifying things in my whole career.
Ernie grew up in Georgia. What most people don't know is that he had a speech impediment. Amazing, perhaps the greatest announcer of all time with a speech impediment. Ernie's love for baseball began when he saw his first game in 1934. It was Babe Ruth's last with the Yankees. In 1948, one of the most bizarre trades in baseball history occurred, and Ernie was right in the middle of it. While working for the Atlanta Crackers, he was traded to the Brooklyn Dodgers. No, not for another announcer, but for a minor league catcher. A few years later, he was behind the mic for one of the most famous home runs in baseball history. No, that wasn't Ernie. It's Russ Hodges. Ernie was doing the game on TV that day, but there's no recording of it, so we'll never know exactly what he said.
So nobody knows except Mrs. Harwell and I that I was on the air that day.
In 1960, he got the job that millions of people would come to associate him with, play-by-play announcer for the Tigers.
But it doesn't make too much difference whether you're for them or against them.
Eight years later, he was calling the shots as the Tigers won the World Series.
Now we've got Jim Northrup.
In 84, a storybook season culminated when Kurt Gibson's blast sealed another World Series championship.
And here's the pitch. He swings as a long drive to right, and it is a home run for Gibson.
I've had the opportunity to work with him every day the last several years, and just to understand what a great person he is, and you know, that'll be equally as big of a loss.
Ernie Harwell is the last of an American breed, a breed that's fading from the American landscape. A man, an announcer, identified with his city. There's only been a few like him. Harry Carey in Chicago, Jack Buck in St. Louis, Vin Scully in Los Angeles. These guys became part of the family, became everybody's best friend. The thing that makes Ernie Harwell so lovable isn't that distinctive voice. It isn't the fact he's been with the Tigers for more than four decades. What makes this man so lovable is the way he treats others. It doesn't matter if you're a former Tiger great or a minor leaguer coming up through the system, or even just an everyday fan. Ernie Harwell treats everyone with the same kind of heartfelt respect.
mister.
Juan, how are you?
There he is. How are you doing?
You know, I'm not really seeking popularity. I just want to treat people the way I want to be treated myself. I'm not too concerned whether a guy's the CEO of a company or works in the basement as a janitor. It's what's in his heart that really matters.
You see, pitch on the way, there's a strike called, and he stood there like the house by the side of the road and watched it go by.
55 years, 8,300 games. Uncle Ernie has only missed two. One for his brother's funeral, the other for his induction into the Baseball Hall of Fame. He knows at that last game Sunday, he'll be overcome with emotion.
It'll be a bittersweet time for me, and it'll be melancholy in a sense, but I know that God's got a new adventure for me, and whatever it is, I'm looking forward to it.
Here it comes, a swing and a bounding ball at the third.
When Tiger Stadium closed its doors, it was Ernie saying the final farewell. This Sunday, Tiger fans will be saying those very same words right back to him.
Farewell, old friend. We will remember.
In a baseball world full of inflated ticket prices, inflated salaries, and inflated egos, Ernie Harwell is the type of person we don't run into very often. And the best part about it is that we all got to share him.
Terrific story.
Yeah.
Gosh.
We won't hear Detroit baseball again the same without that voice.
No.
It's the voice we all grew up with.
They have no idea who's going to replace him, but you can't replace him. You just got to have someone just try to step in and just try to do it.
I wouldn't want to be the guy to take this job
not
next
right
year.
After.
That's for sure. We'll be right back.
Nobody does it better.
He leaps and it is long gone.
Makes me feel sad for the rain.
Thank God. He stood there like the house by the side of the road and watched that one go by.
Half as good as
really, the first double play, two for the price
baby,
of one.
You're the best.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to a melancholy Sunday here in Toronto. Ernie Harwell will be the first to tell you that no one is bigger than the game. But he's wrong. He's bigger than this game today as the Tigers close out their season and he closes out his legendary career. And I want to tell you that we've reached this conclusion. We've leaned on you so much over the last several months. You can't go. We need another year of this, if you don't mind.
Well, John, I enjoy being with you. You've done a fantastic job. And it's a pleasure to work with Fox and all the great workers that they have. And I deeply appreciate their cooperation and their loyalty.
Well, it's our pleasure. Well, let's talk about this day. Any special emotions as you awakened on this Sunday in Toronto?
I think I feel very relaxed. I feel at peace about it. Lulu and I got together in the winter. We made our decision. And I'm going to stick with it. I think it's a thing to do. And the more I think about it, the more right I believe it is. And I know we all have a journey to take, and we all have rites of passage, and this is another rite of passage for me on my journey, and I'm looking forward to whatever comes up.
You've been overwhelmed by attention since you got to the ballpark today. Is there a part of you that will be a little glad when all this has come and gone?
Well, I think it's like high school graduation, you know, you're glad when it's over.
We will carry the final half inning that you broadcast on Fox Sports Net, and of course on the Tigers Radio Network. Do you have any plans at the end of your last game today?
At the end of my last game, I'll say in the ninth inning that I'm going to say goodbye when the game's over after the commercial. And then I'll come back and I'll probably have a little brief statement. I don't think it'll be more than 2 minutes.
Well, I've shared this with you over the course of our time together. I'll always tell you this before the game, don't be nervous. So don't be nervous as you call the last one
I'm
here in Toronto.
I'm going to take your advice.
We're going to bask in our chance to be around our friend Ernie over the course of this afternoon. And as we lead you in the direction of game time, still ahead, Ernie's renowned definition of the game today. You'll want to be with us, a long, warm look back at Ernie and his loves, Lulu and baseball and the Tigers. But up next, he'll retell the tale of how he ended up in our baseball lives. And we come to find out he was a little feisty back in the day.
I was reading the paper, and Leo slapped my paper right back in my face. So I grabbed him, and we began to wrestle.
Wow, I tell you, scandals are right all over the place.
Back in 1951. But he began offering us some of his baseball recollections and memories when we debuted Tigers Weekly. And we've been avid students of the baseball professor ever since.
Hi again, good lookers. I'm Ernie Harwell.
We are here to honor one of baseball's all-time greatest broadcasters, Hall of Fame voice of the Detroit Tigers, Ernie Harwell.
You know, radio and baseball have been married for a long, long time.
Wow, looks like we got a Tiger fan around here. Who would that be?
I wonder.
We're down in the basement now at the Hall of Fame at Cooperstown. This is where they hide the really good stuff. And by the way, how do you like my gloves, Dr. Harwell?
And I'm a proud guy. I got to have a raise. And Jim said, all right, I'll raise your salary one penny the next year.
I'll start off with a mitt. I don't really know where this one came from, but it's big. And it is stiff. Believe me, this is an old-fashioned infielder's glove.
I rode the trains with Roy Campanella, and Jackie Robinson, Pee Wee Reese, all those great boys of summer. He'd had a little whiskey on his breath. I didn't mind that at all. He didn't seem to mind it either. I asked him if I could do the interview. He said, yes, young man, come on in. I sat down, and for 15 minutes, Ty Cobb told me baseball stories. So I was reading the paper, and Leo slapped my paper right back in my face. So I grabbed him, and we began to wrestle.
Wow, I tell you, scandals are right all over the place. Ladies and gentlemen, get your score cards and pencils ready. Johnny Hill from Douglasville never hit. Never will. I might have put him to sleep in the first inning. He might have left me in the fifth. It might have been the 19th. I don't know when, but I put him to sleep. That announcement that Ernie made about the game being postponed was erroneous. Ernie, wherever you are, come on back. That's it for now. See you next time.
Well, all this talk about retirement, he's not retiring from us. Ernie will continue to contribute to vignettes for Tigers Weekly on Fox Sports Net next baseball season. We're thrilled about that. He rejuvenated baseball in Detroit, and Ernie Harwell on this special program is our Just for Men rejuvenator. Just for Men, more than a hair color, it's the rejuvenator. It was 1960, and Ernie was hired away from the Baltimore Orioles, and Detroit suddenly became a better baseball town.
I got a telephone call from George Kell, whom I'd known in Baltimore. And he said that Van Patrick's not coming back to do the Tiger games in 1960. Would you be interested? I said, sure, I'm interested. So he said, well, I'll tell Mr. Sisson, he was the vice president of the Tigers, and he can call you and you can talk to him. So Mr. Sisson called, and they brought me out to Detroit. During the World Series of 1959, I met John Stroh, the owner of a Stroke Brewery, and I met the Tigers, and they decided they'd wanted to give me an offer, so I accepted it.
And that may be looked upon as one of the greatest days in Tiger history. No one can understand the game better than someone who's been around it for six decades. In a moment, baseball prose from perhaps its ultimate poet.
In baseball, democracy shines its clearest. The only race that matters is the race of the bag. The creed is a rule book, and color merely something to distinguish one team's uniform from another. That's baseball.
Of course, but we still have an appreciation for the game, having heard it defined by the likes of Ernie Harwell in a poem that he wrote 47 years ago.
You've got to remember now, this is 1955, that's a long time ago. A lot of things have changed since then, the names of the heroes and the villains. But I think really that the spirit of the game is pretty much the same as it was in 1955. Baseball is the president tossing out the first ball of the season, and a scrubby schoolboy playing catch with his dad on a Mississippi farm. A tall, thin old man waving a scorecard from the corner of his dugout, that's baseball. So is a big, fat guy with a bulbous nose running home one of his 714 home runs. There's a man in Mobile who remembers that Hannes Wagner hit a triple in Pittsburgh 46 years ago. That's baseball. So is a scout reporting that a 16-year-old satellite pitcher in Cheyenne is a coming Walter Johnson. Baseball is a spirited race of man against man, reflex against reflex. A game of inches, every skill, every heroic, every failing is seen and cheered or booed and then becomes a statistic. In baseball, democracy shines its clearest. The only race that matters is the race of the bag. The creed is a rule book and color merely something to distinguish one team's uniform from another. Baseball is a rookie, his experience no bigger than the lump in his throat as he begins fulfillment of his dream. It's a veteran, too, a tired old man of 35, hoping that those aching muscles can pull him through another sweltering August and September. Nicknames are baseball names like Zeke and Pi and Kai Kai and Home Run and Cracker and Dizzy and Dazzy. Baseball is the clear, cool eyes of Rogers Hornsby, the flashing spikes of a Ty Cobb, and an overage pitcher named Rabbit Moranville. Baseball, just a game, as simple as a ball and bat, and yet as complex as the American spirit it symbolizes. It's a sport, a business, sometimes almost even religion. Why, the fairy tale of Willie Mays making a brilliant World Series catch and then dashing off to play stickball in the streets with his teenage pals, that's baseball. And so is the husky voice of a doomed Lou Gehrig saying, I consider myself the luckiest man on the face of this earth. Baseball is cigar smoke, hot roasted peanuts, ladies' day, down in front. Take me out to the ball game and the Star Spangled Banner. Baseball is a man named Campanella telling the nation's business leaders, you have to be a man to be a big leaguer, but you have to have a lot of little boy in you too. This is a game for America, this baseball, a game for boys and for men.
Amazingly, he doesn't read that poem, he recites it off the top of his head. And we are used to his humility and his humor. Each has come in handy as he has made his final lap through the game of baseball. Well, in a moment, you'll get to see the emotional side of this man on his last day as a major league broadcaster.
A lady might write and say, when I hear your voice, I think of my grandfather. I sat on the porch with him, and I didn't know anything about baseball, but your voice was always in the background. It's just a great thing to let people take you into their family.
Tigers or has put a uniform on or been in a booth or front office or anything. He is loved by everybody.
There's no finer person I've ever met, whether it be in baseball or outside of baseball.
I could not tell you, Ernie, how much I pray and hope that you and Miss Lulu will have a wonderful, wonderful retirement.
We wish you nothing but the best. I know you're retiring, but you're not really. It's just a semi-retirement because we all know you're going to be quite busy.
Well, I know in my heart you won't totally retire, but I do know this. You deserve every moment of it. So cherish it because you earned it.
I think God put him on this earth for one reason, to do Tiger games. And he is the very best.
Well put, Mr. K-Line. Baseball's only six-time broadcaster bids us all adieu today, and we will carry his final half inning as a Tiger broadcaster live. We congratulate Ernie on his career, but selfishly, this is an afternoon that we have dreaded, the day the voice is stilled. And Ernie Harwell is long gone because he's been so much a part of us for so very long.
Lo, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth, the time of the singing of birds is come, and the voice of the turtle is heard in our land.
I'm trying to tell you something about my life. Maybe give me insight between black and white. And the best thing you ever done for me is to help me take my life less seriously. It's only life after all.
Yeah. Enjoy the game. Nice to see you.
Thank you.
Have a good time at the game now.
If there is one thing W. Ernest Harwell has taught us all, it's his belief that a person should never take life too seriously. The man whose familiar voice has helped us relive our childhood grew up like most little boys in America, loving the game of baseball.
My childhood was a fairly happy childhood. I had two older brothers, and we all played a little sign-up ball. We loved baseball. My dad was a great baseball fan, and he inculcated into me a love of baseball.
Little boy in a baseball hat stands in the field with his ball and bat.
My first game that I ever saw was in 1926. On the 4th of July, my dad took me to a doubleheader. That was before he was stricken with multiple sclerosis. And the Crackers were playing the New Orleans Pelicans. And a fellow named Eddie Morgan hit a home run. I remember that, but I don't remember much else about the game. But I was hooked from then on.
Now the little boy doesn't say a word. Picks up his ball. He is undeterred.
Well, I had a speech impediment from about the time I was 3 or 4 years old up until grammar school. And it was called tongue-tied. I couldn't say an S, I couldn't say a CH, I'd say ficken instead of chicken. And if I wanted to say Susie, I'd say foozy. And I think maybe a lot of people think I'm still tongue-tied.
Now it's supper time, and his mama calls. Little boy starts home with his bat and ball.
When I was very young, I wanted to be a big league ball player, and I found out I couldn't make it. And then when I was in high school, I connected with the Sporting News. I wrote the editor, and he didn't know I was only 16 years old, so he gave me the job as Atlanta correspondent. And that's when I really connected up with the media, 1934, the year that Sparky Anderson and Al Kaline were born.
Ernie's work in newspapers continued for 6 years until a small station in Atlanta, WSB, gave him his first shot at broadcasting. He soon became the play-by-play voice of the Atlanta Crackers and has stayed behind the mic ever since, getting his shot at the major leagues in a most unique way.
When I was working with the Crackers in 1948, Red Barber, the great Brooklyn announcer, became ill on a trip to Pittsburgh. He had an ulcer perforate on him. And the Branch Rickey, his boss, contacted the fellow that owned the Atlanta Crackers, Earl Mann, and said, I'd like to have Ernie Harwell come up and replace Red. And Earl Mann said, well, Mr. Rickey, that's good, but I've got Ernie under contract. If you really want him badly enough, you send me your catcher from Montreal, Cliff Dappert. So I got to the big leagues, traded for a minor league catcher.
In 1950, Ernie was lured to the rival New York Giants, where 1 year later he would broadcast the debut of Willie Mays. Soon he'd move on to Baltimore, where he spent six seasons before making Detroit his new home in 1960.
But it doesn't make too much difference whether you're for him or against him. I think that everybody realizes the strengths and the weaknesses of the Detroit Ball Club for 1960.
How about the young fellas, Al, on this team? You think we've got some pretty good prospects?
Oh, yes, we have some real fine ball players, and
I tell you, this ball club is going to have a real great future.
He swings a line shot. Base hit. Right field. The Tigers win it. Here comes K-Line to score. And it's all over. Downward singles. The Tigers mob down. K-Line has scored. The fans are steaming on the field. And the Tigers have won their first pennant since 1945.
I think my style is repertorial. I try to be as brief as I can and try to be as clear as I can.
Swung on and drives the left. That'll be the ball game. It's over the head of Gardner. And McClain has his 30th victory of the 1968 season.
Gentle wait. Here it comes. He struck him out, and Morris has a no-hitter.
Here's the pitch. He swings as a long drive to right, and it is a home run for Gibson.
The pitch, he swings, and there's a fly ball to left. Here comes Herndon. He's there. He's got it. The Tigers are the champions of 1984.
My fondest memory of broadcasting will be the people that I've met, the people on the field, the umpires, the players, the managers and the coaches. And they're the focal point of the game. And then the media, the guys have always been great to me. But the people of the game in it and around it are the ones that mean the most to me.
Okay. But there's an English rose named Abraham Darby.
Old Abraham Darby, yeah, he was a great...
Away from the ballpark, there's no question who is most important in his life.
And this one's Betty Boop.
Oh, Betty Boop. I remember when she was in the movies.
Lulu Tankersley. A woman who over 60 years ago gave up her former name to be Mrs. Ernie Harwell has been by his side through every game, every story, every call. The remarkable Miss Lulu was always there in his heart, supporting her husband in every dream he pursued.
We'd go together like a wink and a smile.
Well, she's got a lot of patience to begin with, and she's very adaptive. And when we're going out, she can get dressed in a hurry. She's got a lot of wonderful qualities, but most of all, she's self-sacrificing, and she's very lovable. And she was at home to take care of things and be mom and dad when I was away, which was, of course, half my lifetime. And I owe a whole lot to her. She's the best thing ever happened to me.
Thank you.
With a wink.
Ernie Harwell is so much more than a baseball announcer. He's a gateway to our past. Our favorite team, our favorite player. He's helped us to recall our best baseball memories, and as well, he's a part of our families, part of the fabric that makes up what is so special about growing up in Detroit.
I don't think anything nicer to a guy can happen than that, because I hear a lady might write and say, when I hear your voice, I think of my grandfather. I sat on the porch with him, and I didn't know anything about baseball, but your voice was always in the background. It's just a great thing to let people take you into their family, and then they can tell you about it, and I love to hear that. I really do.
McGregor kicks and deals. Here's a fly ball left, and maybe it's deep.